we pray. Pastor Harold was saying to me, Lord was speaking to him even while we were singing that song about God not relenting. You won't relent, oh God. God does not relent. He does not stop. And Harold was saying that we need to meet God's relentlessness with our own. Amen? That when I was saying, go stand under these banners this morning, I was hearing the Lord say, yes, if they stand under those banners, and I didn't say this, that they need to stay there until they get that answer. Stay in that place. It's just a demonstration. I'm going to stay in this place of believing and trusting you here, oh God, until I see this come to pass. You know what I'm saying? I'm saying this. Now, we were doing a natural demonstration, but it's a spiritual reality that I was declaring today that we stand in that place. Lord, you are Jehovah Jireh. You are Jehovah Rapha. You are Jehovah Shalom. This is who you are, and I'm going to stand in this place. I am relentless to call on your name in this place. And you will answer me. You will answer. I know when I went over there and I started to praise him, I started to praise him as Jehovah Rapha. I came this morning rough pain in my back. I walked over there in great pain. I started to praise him and lift up my hands. I was still in pain. And the Lord says, just start moving around. He's like, come on, let's go. You get into this. And so I just went like this, and immediately it was gone. Immediately it was gone. The answer comes from the sanctuary. The answer, this is his word. We're standing on this word. It's true or it's not. Do we stand on it or not? I believe it's truth, so we need to stand on it. And I'm not saying that for me. I'm just saying. And then when I started to walk back over here, guess what? Pain came back. Pain was like, no, that's not, you didn't get healed over there. And so then I kept worshiping. I kept worshiping. I'm going to say, no, the liar is the devil. The liar is the devil. The devil's a liar. Either way. That's a quotable right there. The liar is the devil. More true than you know. Okay, the devil is a liar, and he is the father of all lies, and he wants to get us to bite on, oh, no, I didn't get that healing from the Lord. I didn't get what I really needed. He didn't really answer me in his holy heaven. He didn't answer me in the sanctuary. He wants to get us that way. I'm not any different than anybody else. And so what do? So I kept pressing in. So I relentlessly pursue my Lord that is my healer. Lord, you are my healer. You are my trust. You are the Lord who heals me. You heal me today. You answer me in the day that I call. You answer me not tomorrow. You're answering me today. And so I believe and I stand on that today. And so I come up here and it abates. It starts to diminish. As I speak to you and as I praise him, it begins to just completely go away again. Isn't that interesting? This is the kingdom of God. Let's focus on what he says and not on what I feel, what I think, what I see. That's being relentless. I need to be relentless in tribulation, relentless in struggle. I'm going to lay hands on, I'm going to grab hold of my God, and I will not let go. I will not relent. Mary Magdalene was at the crucifixion. She saw it all. She was there for every bit of it. Did she leave? No. She followed the body to the tomb. She went and she got even things to come. And when they open that tomb, I'm going to be a first one in there. And I'm going to anoint his head. And I'm going to just pour myself on him. What happens? We see that Jesus wasn't there. And she was shocked. But then Jesus reveals himself to her. He only says one thing. And she knows it soon. She says, Mary. He says her name. And as soon as he says her name, she drops at his feet. She says, Rabboni, teacher. She falls at his feet and grabs hold of him. I think that's a great picture for all of us. Doesn't matter what I've seen. Doesn't matter what I've experienced. The great loss that even that I've had in my own heart. The pain that I've endured. Seeing what I've seen. I'm going to keep holding on. This is an end time. This is the end times we are in, I believe. These are the last days. These are the last days. We need to grab hold of the strategies of the last days. This is part of these strategies of the last days. Grabbing hold, prayers of the saints. And I'm going to come into, and I'm going to speak this morning on, I believe it's an end time strategy. And we'll get here in just a minute. You can start turning to Psalm 132. Paul says to Timothy that in the last days, perilous times will come. Why was he telling him that? Man, Paul, you're just speaking death. You're just trying to get me into fear. He's saying, perilous times are coming, and I want you to prepare is really what it is. I want you to recognize. Recognize that there are perilous times coming. But Jesus said, be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Jesus said the same thing. Jesus said, you know, they have persecuted me. They're going to persecute you. Tribulation's going to come to you, but be of good cheer. I'm not talking about pre-mid, post-trib, you know, all of these tribs. I'm talking about just sufferings, okay? I'm talking suffering, that there are believers going through tribulation today, maybe even right now, most likely right now, that our hearts need to be stirred today to believe God, that He is the same yesterday, today, and forever, that He is their portion, He is their strength, He is their shield. He is an ever-present help in trouble. That this is our God, and He does not change. So as we come into these last days, certainly circumstances may get chaotic around us. One thing never changes: our God. He never changes. He is our strength. He is the strong tower that we run to in times of trouble, and we are saved. This is our God. We need to be aware, and I'm not saying be a just a bad news junkie, but in this world we can see all sorts of things happening because of the kingdom of darkness, and we don't bury our head in the sand and say, "Ooh, you know, I'm just not gonna think about it." The Lord says, "No, I want you to meet all of those things with trust and praise and faith." That this is what I'm calling my people to be. This is a mature bride of Christ that can respond to these things in this way. What shall we say to these things? Persecutions, nakedness, peril, sword. What should we say to all these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? I encourage you Well, I'm just starting to get into my message. Let us join together in these days, and it is an end time strategy. And I believe, and this is the title of my message this morning, I was talking about God, a heart after God's own heart, and we saw that in David. This morning I'm talking about a kingdom of habitation. That I believe that an end time strategy is being a part of this kingdom of habitation. What does this kingdom look like? What does it mean to be a part of this kingdom? How do we operate in this kingdom? And I believe it just comes down the line that God desired this from the very, very beginning. He created Adam and Eve for habitation. He created them for connection. And we realize all through the Old Testament, all through the saints of God, that God was reestablishing, He was reconnecting, He was showing more of Himself. He just kept showing himself. And that we finally see that David is catching hold of the heart of God for this communion, for this habitation. That God doesn't want to just have this once in a while visit with me. He wants to have this enduring dwelling presence that guides me in everything that I do. And that It's not just visitation that God wants, and David understood that. It's not just, I don't want you here just for winning this battle for me, God. I don't want you to just come and give me this provision or to set me free. Lord, I want you to be with me all the time. That David was delighted. He was dancing it, and we need to see that picture of David dancing before the Lord as the ark is brought into Jerusalem. With all his might, it says. That David even says to his wife, he says, you know, I'll be even more undignified. I'll be even more undignified than this because I am so delighted that God is here among us. That God resides here. That it's not a come and go. It's his presence is what defines us. As Moses said, I'm not going from this place, Moses said to God up on Mount Sinai. I'm not going from this place if your presence doesn't go with us. That you are the one who defines me. My identity is in you, God. And as the people of God, our identity is in your presence being with us. Our identity today, in this world, in these perilous times, is our God is with us. He is with us. And that God is desiring not just visitation, but he's desiring habitation. And he wants hearts that want the same thing. Just as Pastor Harold was talking about, we meet God's relentlessness with our own relentlessness. He wants to meet his desire for this intimacy. He wants us to have this same desire. He didn't create us. He didn't create us as robots to say, oh yes, I must love God. You know, that was my poor imitation of a robot. We must love God. We must bow down. We must worship. He didn't create us that way, did he? He created us with choice, that he values this. He desires this. He desires our will, that we choose him. You know what I love about my wife is that she chose me. She chose to be in relationship with me. I chose her as well. I chose her right back. You know, that we chose each other to have relationship, that God didn't want that to be set aside, that he wants these matching desires to come together. And that this is what David demonstrated. He demonstrated to the people. He demonstrated it to all Israel. That certainly he was a warrior, but then he came in as a lover, didn't he? That people saw David as a lover of God. That he demonstrated that before the people, that David pursued God with all that he had. And then it just, that David's pursuit is what hits me strongly. David's pursuit spread. It didn't just stay in one place. That when I see people just get on fire for God, and just go after God and just are undone in his presence and just are pouring themselves out and they're just abandoning themselves. What it does to me, it shows me that God is meeting that person in that place. And it's stirring my own heart to get into that same place. I'm thanking God for, oh, I thank you, God, that you are meeting with that person. Because I know what it means. It means that you meet with me in that same way. That you all have an effect on me. And I believe that I have an effect on you. And my pursuit, or lack thereof, has an effect on you. And that we see that David's pursuit of the Father heart of God was passed on. And we read it right away that it was passed on to his son Solomon. That Solomon caught Not just the ideas and the purposes of David, but he caught the heart of David. And we see this in Psalm 132, and then we're going to go back into 1 Kings. But in Psalm 132, and this is a prayer of blessing in the sanctuary, and this was attributed to Solomon, and it says, "Remember, O Lord, on David's behalf, all his affliction, how he swore to the Lord and vowed to the mighty one of Jacob, 'Surely I will not enter my house, nor lie on my bed. I will not give sleep to my eyes or slumber to my eyelids until I find a place for the Lord, a dwelling place for the mighty one of Jacob.'" Solomon is saying this. Solomon is remembering David's heart to see the habitation of God. Solomon is crying this back to God. And then he says, "For the Lord," in verse 13, "For the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his habitation. This is my resting place forever. Here I will dwell, for I have desired it." God says, back to this prayer. "I will abundantly bless her with provision. I will satisfy her needy with bread, her priests also with the cloth of with salvation, and her godly ones will sing aloud for joy. There I will cause the horn of David to spring forth. I have prepared a lamp for my anointed. His enemies I will clothe with shame upon himself. His crown shall shine." But God says, "I'm going to meet you, David. I'm going to meet this place, this horn of David, this spring of David, this offshoot. I'm going to meet this with glory, with myself." That Solomon caught David's heart. And we see it if you turn back in 1 Kings chapter 3. And this is after David has passed away and Solomon becomes king. And he begins to rule. And Solomon, as he's ruling and as things are coming together, it says that Solomon is praise in 1 Kings 3:6. It says, "Then Solomon said, 'You have shown great loving kindness to your servant David, my father.'" Solomon was still thinking of his father. "According as he walked before you in truth and righteousness and uprightness of heart toward you." He was remembering his heart. "And you have reserved for him this great loving kindness, that you have given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day. Now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. Yet I'm but a little child. I do not know how to go out or how to come in." And that is talking, it's talking about how to lead the people. And in David's case, it was leading them into war and leading them into promise. It was also a type of leading them into the presence and leading them out of the presence in strength. "I don't yet know how to do that, what my father did. Your servant is in the midst of your people, which you have chosen, a great people who are too many to be numbered or counted. So give your servant an understanding," what? Heart. When everyone thinks about Solomon, they think about the wisdom of Solomon, and we think it's here. That's not what this is saying. "Give your servant an understanding heart." And really, the word understanding is hearing. Give me a hearing heart. Give me a heart that catches what you're saying, that knows what your heart is. Your people, that give me a discerning heart to judge your people, to discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of yours? This is so good. And God answers Solomon. He says, "It was pleasing in the sight of the Lord that Solomon asked this thing." that he was meeting the heart of God. He was meeting God's desire. You have asked for a good thing. God said to him, because you have asked this thing and have not asked for yourself long life or riches, nor have you asked for life, the life of your enemies, but ask for yourself discernment, hearing, to understand justice. Behold, I have done according to your words. Behold, what does God give him? He says, I have given you a wise and discerning heart. I have given you a heart like your father. So that there has been no one like you before you, and shall no one be like you that will be after you. And then I will also give you all of these other things. I'm going to give you riches. I'm going to give you all the things of the, you know, he just goes to pour on. He says, but the Lord was meeting Solomon with this place, and he was catching, just as he was catching the heart, God's heart was catching David's heart, and David was catching God's heart, that we see this same thing now happening in Solomon. And when I think about then Solomon then decides to build. So he pursues. There's a pursuit, and then there was the second thing that happens is that Solomon then decides, okay, I'm going to do this thing that was in my father's heart. I'm going to make this habitation. We're going to do it. And we read this, if you go over to 1 Kings chapter 5, 1 through 7. And what's interesting with where the temple is built, and this is to this day, and it was built on Mount Moriah. And if you remember what Mount Moriah was, when God grabbed a hold of Abram, and he told Abram, you know, I want you to go outside, I want you to look at the stars in the heavens. I want you to count them, Abram. And he couldn't count them. And he says, such will be your descendants. Such will be your descendants forever. And then we know that he gives his son Isaac to Abraham, who is the child of promise. And then God asks of Isaac, the son. And then he says, I want you to go to the mount. And he takes Isaac to Mount Moriah. And this is where Abraham, as he's climbing this mountain, says, the Lord will provide. The Lord will do this thing that he has said. And that right before he plunges the sword into Isaac, the angel comes and stays his hand. And the Lord says to him, because you have done this thing, you know, certainly everything that I have said will come to pass. I will bless you and make your name great. And this is on Mount Moriah. Well, then David, after he asked for his officials to go and count all the people, and he wanted to get the number of his army. I want to see how great my army is. I want to see how many I've got so I know what I can do when we match up against these other armies. And it grieved God. It angered the Lord because he didn't inquire of God on this. And David was met with the priest, and the priest was like, you really missed the heart of God on this one, David. And he realized, yes, I did. And so he went and bought a field, and it was the threshing floor, actually, of Aruana. And on this threshing floor that he offered sacrifices to God, and that God then met David in this place, and he stopped the plague. And this was the place where David said, I will not give to the Lord. That David, this was that same place. And so now Solomon is going to build this habitation. And this is where he chooses. This is where God's choice of habitation was, where there was hearts coming together. Are you seeing this picture? That he was catching heart, that Abraham was catching the heart of God in this place, and he was giving his only son Just as Heavenly Father would give His only Son, that David was catching the heart of the Father, that He was a healer, that He was the restorer. He was the one that, I want you to come to me with everything, David. He says, this is where I want you to establish the habitation, this place of the heart. That this is the habitation that I desire, and that Solomon agrees and grabs hold of it. In verse 1 of chapter 5, it says, 1 Kings 5, now Hiram, king of Tyre, sent his servants to Solomon when he heard that they had anointed him king in place of his father. For Hiram had always been a friend of David. Then Solomon sent word to Hiram, saying, you know that David, my father, was unable to build a house for the name of the Lord his God because of the wars which surrounded him, until the Lord put them under the soles of his feet. We also know that because David had blood on his hand, he couldn't build. But now the Lord, my God, has given me rest on every side. There is neither adversary nor misfortune. Behold, I intend to build a house for the name of the Lord, my God. And the word for intend means say. Behold, I say, build a house for the name of the Lord. As the Lord spoke to David, my father, saying, your son, whom I will set on your throne in your place, he will build a house for my name. Now, therefore, command that they cut for me cedars of Lebanon, and your servants will bring all these things to me and bring all the timber. It says in verse 7, when Hiram heard the words of Solomon, he rejoiced greatly and said, blessed be the Lord today, who has given to David a wise son over his great people. That Hiram was stirred up, that he got stirred up. This is good. Yes, you are carrying on the heart of your father. That you are continuing with his desire that God had put into him. And that Solomon does this connection with Hiram. And he begins to build. And it says later on in chapter 5, he grabs laborers. 30,000 laborers, 70,000 transporter, 80,000 stone cutters, 3,300 chief deputies or managers of all of these things. What are we up to? 183,000 workers on one building. That he's bringing in all of these things. All of these precious stones, the timbers. It says that it was estimated that at least 20 tons of gold was used in Solomon's temple. That there was just this heart that Solomon had to make this glorious place for God. Oh God, prepare the sanctuary. Let us prepare the sanctuary. That 7 years these workers were building, were forming, were fashioning, that he grabs Hiram, and Hiram was this, it says in verse 13 of chapter 7, that Hiram was a worker in bronze, and he was filled with wisdom and understanding and skill for doing all kinds of work in bronze. And then 2 Chronicles chapter 2, it also talks more about Hiram. And it says that he was skilled in all kinds of things, in fabrics and fashioning vessels and everything. And that he grabbed hold of him. And Hiram didn't just do it because he was skilled at it, but I believe it's because he caught the heart. That Solomon caught the heart of David, and then he dispensed it to everyone around him. Can you think of all these 183,000 workers? What are we doing? They were all talking about what we are doing. What are we doing this for? What are we making here? They were all gathering together with common purpose to see a habitation for God. And it says if you go back to chapter 6, verse 11, and the word of the Lord came to Solomon, saying, concerning this house, which you are building. If you will walk in my statutes and execute my ordinances and keep all my commandments by walking in them, then I will carry out my word with you, which I spoke to David your father. And he goes on. And I will dwell among the sons of Israel and will not forsake my people Israel. So Solomon built the house and finished it. What's interesting to me is God doesn't say, and I'm going to dwell in this house. You notice what he's saying there? You're building this house unto my name. And in fact, when Solomon keeps praying to God, just believing in what he's going to do, God is saying, and I will dwell among my sons. I will dwell, and he says, I will dwell in the midst of them. The word is center, or the heart of. I will dwell in the center of my sons. I will dwell in the heart of my people. That this is what I desire. And then it just gets better. And then we go to when the temple is finished. Let's go over to 2 Chronicles. And I like this account. And Chronicles and Kings in many ways is kind of like the Gospels. They parallel each other. Okay, they're the same events. And they're just told from maybe just a little bit different perspectives. And in 2 Chronicles, we have in chapter 5. Chapter 5, and we'll go to 11 and 14. But we see in chapter 5, verse 1 of chapter 5, thus all the work that Solomon performed for the house of the Lord was finished. And Solomon brought all the things that David had, his father had dedicated, even the silver and the gold and all the utensils, and put them in the treasuries of the house of God. And you know that everything in the temple was overlaid in gold. I mean, the building itself. Now, there were other different vessels and cloths and different things, but all of the house, even the floor, was gold. Everything was finished. And it says in verse 11, when the priests came forth from the holy place, for all the priests who were present had sanctified themselves without regard to divisions. And all the Levitical singers came together, Asaph, Heman, Jeduthun, and their sons and kinsmen, clothed in fine linen with cymbals and harps and lyres, standing east of the altar, and with 120 priests blowing trumpets. In unison, when the trumpeters and the singers were to make themselves heard with one voice. Okay, let me just say, 120, I can't even hold it. What does 120 mean to you? There was 120 in the upper room that are waiting for the glory of God. That were praying together as one, in one heart, with one confession. And believing that God would come, that the things that Jesus had just said 50 days prior would come to pass. And they were contending and they were relentless and they believed that God, who said what he said, and he was able to perform it. A 120 priests blowing the trumpets in unison. When the trumpeters and the singers were to make themselves heard with one voice to praise and to glorify the Lord, and when they lifted up their voice, accompanied by trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, my tears are making it hard to read. And when they praised the Lord, saying, he indeed is good, for his loving kindness is everlasting, then the house of the Lord was filled with a cloud, so that the priests could not stand to minister because of the cloud. For the glory of the Lord filled the house of God. Then Solomon said, the Lord has said he would dwell in a thick cloud. I have built you a lofty place, a lofty house, and a place for your dwelling forever. And then the king Solomon turned, and he faced the people, and he began to bless them. This is the fulfillment of God's words. You are seeing it right now. What has been passed down from my father to me, to you, that you now stand in this place of the glory of God. Then it says in verse 12, then he stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands. Now Solomon had made a bronze platform, place for him to be. And as he stood, he stood on it, and then he knelt down on his knees in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands towards heaven. And he prays, and he prays, and he prays. All of the rest of chapter 6 is his prayer, calling out to God. If they return to you with their hearts, if their hearts are towards you in verse 30, and if they return to you with all of their hearts in verse 38, then hear from heaven. Be open to their cries. Now, when Solomon had finished praying, this is chapter 7, verse 1, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. The priests could not enter into the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled the Lord's house. And all of the sons of Israel, seeing the fire come down and the glory of the Lord upon the house, bowed down on the pavement with their faces to the ground. They worshiped and gave praise to the Lord, saying, truly he is good. Truly his loving kindness is everlasting. Truly he is God. That we see in this picture, we see the pursuit of the heart of God. We see the connection, the joining with David, with Solomon, with the workers, with the people, with the heart of God. And then we see the filling of the heart of God. That God's desire is to fill. And what happened, I love this, that it didn't just happen once. It happens twice. This wasn't a retelling. This was after his prayer. That when the priest came out of the holy place, then the glory of God, the kabod and glory of God came and rested on that place. And that when Solomon comes and he says, yes, surely God is in this place. And that there is this sacrifice here on the altar. And he's down on his knees and he's calling to God, receive this place. Lord, we dedicate this place to you. And the trumpets and everything is sounding and resounding. And then God sends his fire down and consumes the sacrifice. And they all see it. What I see in this picture is God's heart when he was showing Abraham the skies. And he was showing him, such will be your descendants, Abraham. You can't even count them. I believe that he was not just showing Abraham the blessings that he would walk in. I believe that he was showing Abraham what he wanted to fill. That I want to fill the heavens, fill the universe, fill this place with my glory. I'm going to fill all of your descendants with myself. Just as I have filled, just as I fill David, I fill Solomon, I fill the house, I fill the priests, I fill the people. I desire to fill. That is my desire. This is the point of habitation. Not that we just are owned by God, but that we are filled by God. And that he will meet our pursuit, our connection. He will meet our crying out with himself. That God desires not just a heart, but hearts. He is desiring a kingdom of priests. That this was spoken in the Exodus, that Moses said, God desires to make you all king, all priests unto God. It was spoken to Moses, and he says, yes, I want all of them to come, and I want them to worship me. But because they were afraid, they wouldn't go up. Moses, you go up, and you hear God on our behalf. We're afraid. But he continues to say, and that Jesus even responds. And then Peter says, you are made into a kingdom, a holy nation, to God's own possession. And then John hears from Jesus, you were made a kingdom of priests unto our God. That this is what he's looking for. He's looking for the kingdom of hearts that are his. That you get the picture of David dancing and delighting before the ark of God. And I almost hear God saying, it's just a seed. That was just a seed for his people, for his descendants, that this is the throne. This is the throne that I delight in. This is what I see, that this is the throne. This is the horn that is arising, that this is what the angels came to announce when Jesus came to the earth. Upon his throne, upon David's throne, does Jesus come and sit. That it's a kingdom of habitation. And so if God is desiring this incredible kingdom, what is our part in this? So let's just go. Let's go to Acts chapter 2. Well, you know, I want to, let me just say, let me go to 1 Peter. First Peter chapter 2. First Peter chapter 2 is such a great expression of what we're talking about. Have you guys ever seen most of you have seen Extreme Home Makeover. Have anybody ever seen that? If you want to cry, if you have just a little ounce of, you know, compassion and mercy, you're going to cry at that show. Anybody else cry at that show? I have. I know I've shed a couple tears. I mean, it's engaging. But what happens is, if you're not familiar with the show, is there's usually a family, and they've gone through a lot of different struggles and just a lot of circumstances that have happened, and their house is just in disarray and almost ready to even lose their houses a lot of times. And I don't know, somebody sends in their name to this show or the producers, and they get a hold of these people, and they go and they come with this group of people, and then the guy's name is Ty Pennington, who's in charge of the whole thing, and they come to the house, and because a lot of people know the show, Ty Pennington will stand there with a bullhorn and say, Johnson family! You know, he'll call out to them. And almost always, the people come running out of the house and tackle him. Because they're so excited because they know what's going to happen. But what happens is, they actually send the family away. And then they remake this house just to be this incredible house that this family really needs. What I really appreciate, what I like about it, is they meet with the family, and they talk to the family, and they get a feel for the family, and what the uniqueness is of is, you know, what they like and what they don't like and things that mean a lot to them, and then they form and fashion this plan. And they all come together, and they send the family away, and then Ty Pennington comes in and you know, gives them this, you know, we're going to do this for this family. And they even show a video of what the family has gone through. And you're just like, your heart is just, oh, you know, all the things that this family has been through. And then they come in, and they just start, and they just usually just demolish the house. And they begin building. And they do all these special rooms, like, for each of the kids. And something that the kids like. And it's just formed and fashioned just for them. And what I really appreciate about it is there's this gathering. And there's, like, this momentum. Well, it's done in just usually a week, I believe. And they are just working and working. Actually, Pastor Dwayne worked on one of them that was just right around here. Was it in Hawkins? I don't know. It was somewhere close here. They just gather all these people, and they get it done, and usually there's a lot of pressure to get it done, just to finish everything out, and they finally, you know, every show is like, will they get it done? Can they do it? Can they do it? You know, every show, you know, that's how they work. And so finally they bring the family back, and they put this big bus up in front of the house so the family can't see what's going on. And then, I mean, this is just part of the shtick of the show. Ty Pennington, you know, kind of gives the thumbs up to the whole crowd. And they said, move that bus! And the bus moves. And, I mean, this usually gets me, like, every time. It's even getting me right now, because I just watched a couple of them last night. But to see just this really beautiful place, and it was what I think makes it so beautiful is that it's the place where they belong. It's their home. It's theirs. It's what we should have been all from the beginning. And I think it just strikes a chord in me because I believe that God has called us to this same place, this kind of habitation, that there is this place of belonging. There is a place where we all gather around and say, yes, this is the place. This is what God intends for all of us to be part of, to be in. And that I think that we have examples than in the New Testament. I believe Jesus did this with his life. He was pursuing the heart of God. He was displaying God's desire to the disciples. He grabbed hold of the disciples, didn't he? Come follow me. And they began to catch. They began to catch not just Jesus' heart, but the Father's heart. That Jesus was giving them what God's desire was, what the truths were. That he was showing them and demonstrating what this habitation means on the earth. And then he promises, he says, you know, and I'm going to go, but it's to your advantage that I go. Because I'm going to send you one, and he's not going to be limited by this flesh in any way. And he is going to be in you. And that Jesus then calls us into this same position today, I believe. That we are now his instruments. We are now the incarnation of Christ Jesus on the earth. We are who he is. We're Jesus with flesh on. This is what we are. And that we see in 1 Peter chapter 2, it says, and coming to him as to a living stone which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious. You also, as living stones, he was just talking about Jesus. He says, you also, just like Jesus, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And down in verse 9, But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who's called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. That you have this special calling, and we are all priests of God. We are all priests of God, and priest means really sacrifice. That we are living sacrifices to God, that we give ourselves to our God. We give ourselves to him that he might inhabit us. But look, is this just a singularity? And you, one person, are a living stone. Well, yeah, kind of, but that's not what he says. You are living stones. Plural. Plural. Catch this picture. We are living stones. That we are the temple. Because we'll say, well, my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Yes, that's true. But we are the temple that God builds for his habitation. In the West, we really grab hold of independence. We grab a hold of the importance of individuality. That's not really an Old Testament concept. The individuality was only to help the corporate group. It was only to bring strength to the whole and not just be an independent part that takes care of myself and I don't need anybody. That's not the Old Testament concept, and it's not the New Testament concept either. That he has called us to be a kingdom of priests. In order to be a priest, you got to be a part of the kingdom. In order to be of the kingdom, you need to be connected with other priests, is how I'm reading it. That how is he building us together? He's building us, he's building the people that are pursuing Jesus with all their heart, that are joining together as they're doing this. That this is the temple of God. And that we are filled when this temple is filled. That all of us come as open vessels. As Elisha was saying to the widow, the prophet's widow, and he said, I want you to gather the vessels. Don't get just a few. I want you to gather them up because we're going to fill. I'm going to fill. And how many got filled? All of them that were gathered. I'm believing that the gathering brings the filling. Do you see what I'm saying? It's in this gathering that it's not just a single pursuit, it's a corporate pursuit of filling. It's a corporate pursuit of habitation. I thought it was good. but it, in order for that to happen, we must connect. Right? We have to connect one with another. That doesn't mean that we have no distinctions, because actually God likes all those distinctions. He likes all the uniquenesses. And in fact, he wants those uniquenesses to be together with the other uniquenesses, because it makes this beautiful, beautiful temple that he desires to inhabit. That in... Repeatedly, he says, I want you to be, that we are built up in our faith, that build one another up. Do not let any unwholesome words come out of your mouth, but only what is benefiting or building the others. That there is this building that happens, and that Paul says in Ephesians that we are fitted together, and that we grow up when we are actually fitted together. In fact, part of my growing up means that I am fitting together. That I believe that this is a strategy for this day, that we are not by ourselves, that the strength of the Lord comes when we are fitted together rightly fitted together rightly means I am intentional to grab hold of my brother and sister's hand to be rightly connected with them, that I need their input into my life. I love prayers together because we hear the heart of God coming out of my brothers and sisters, and I catch that heart, and it builds in me and fills me where I may have never been filled before because of their unique filling. I need every one of you. And I'll say, God needs every one of you. God needs every one of you for the filling of this place. You are the filling of what God wants to do. That he's looking for the vessels, and he's looking for those who are pursuing God, and we're pursuing him together. We are connecting together. We are building each other up together to see his glory come. And it's just this perfect, it's such a perfect picture, and I kind of gave the punchline away because I couldn't handle it anymore with Acts chapter 2. Jesus says, even in Acts 1, Jesus says when he comes back, when he comes and he's just about to ascend to the heavens and he's speaking to the disciples one last time, he says, John baptized you with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. In verse 8, and you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and even to the remotest part of the earth. When the day of Pentecost had come, verse 1 of chapter 2, and suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind. It was filled. The whole house was filled where they were sitting. What were they doing this time? It says that they were praying. They were crying out to God. It says, and they were appeared to them tongues as a fire, distributing themselves as they rested on each one of them. We see it's coming on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance. That here we see the gathering of the saints together. They were passionately desiring what God wanted for his own habitation, for his kingdom to come, for these great things that Jesus had said to happen. And they were contending for it. They were believing. They were praying together. And then God meets them in this place. Just as he met Solomon in the dedication. It says, and there were all kinds of Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from a nation under heaven. And when the sound occurred, the crowd came together and were bewildered because of each one was hearing them speak in his own language. They were amazed and astonished. How is this that we hear them in our own language to which we were born? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia and Judea, Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and districts of Libya around Cyrene, and the visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them in our own tongues speaking of the mighty deeds of God. Oh, it's just so good. Jesus ministered to the Jews, you know, and he ministered to Galilee, and he ministered just to that, just to Israel in that one location. And you see then God drawing peoples from every tribe, tongue, and nation. And that this, you know, it's all by design that God used this time when these people were gathering for the first fruits, for the harvest of first fruits, for Shavuot, and he gathering the people together, and there he pours out himself. That God was like, you know, it's not enough. I love that you guys are pursuing me with everything that you have. I love that there's 120 here together just pursuing my heart, but it's not big enough for my glory. My glory has to extend. And that it begins to extend. And we know that that Peter gets up and he begins just to declare. The giftings of God that were in Peter just begin to come out. And I believe that this is what we need. We need the giftings. We need your gifting because it's part of this body's filling, part of this body's habitation, what the unique expression is of this church, of these people coming together, and that Peter begins to stand up and he begins to preach the word. And what does it say? It says that 3,000 come to the Lord that day. 3,000. 3,000. 3,000 who? 3,000 foreigners that are just about to go back to where they came from. That this gospel, this desire of God to be the habitation just begins, and it just begins to spread. He says, and he preaches again, and 5,000 come to Christ. So now this habitation of 120 now is 8,120 in just a span of a few days. And then God is saying, yes, this is my kingdom. Jesus says, such is the kingdom of God. It may be just the smallest little seed, but it becomes one of the biggest trees that all the birds can come and sit in. Such is the kingdom of God. And I just believe, and I hope you're catching my heart this morning, that I believe that God is calling us as a kingdom of habitation in these days. And that kingdom of habitation doesn't happen with us just by myself. I have to connect with you in order to grow, in order to be mature, in order to be filled. Can you catch my heart this morning? Because this is what is going to meet the darkness on this earth. This, not just this by myself. Yeah, I could do that with God on my side, but that wasn't God's intention. His intention was for us to be locked arm in arm together, believing and trusting He is my God, and what we have seen, we know that He is able to perform, and He will continue to do it until the day of Jesus Christ. Lord, we stand together and we believe together. This is the habitation that He's calling us to. Lord, let us get this picture. Let us understand your heart for this. That even as the heavens, as the stars fill the sky, so you desire that your kingdom would extend, would expand, would grow. Because what can possibly match your glory? But something that was so infinite as it would just continue to go on and on and on. A growing kingdom. This is what God's called us to. I want to minister this morning, and I'm gonna ask the ministry teams to come forward. And we're gonna pray together. We're gonna believe for the filling of God's glory in this temple. And let me say this: we're used to doing this. Okay, one person comes up. One person is gonna come up, and I'm gonna have, you know, two or three people pray for me. That's not what I'm asking for this morning. I mean, if you really feel like you have to do it just by yourself, I guess we can do that. That's not what I want, though. I want you to grab one or two or three others, and I want you to come that the temple might be filled. I want you to grab maybe someone, you know, I really want to pursue the Lord together with you. Maybe it's your spouse. Maybe it's your kids. I want you to come. I want you to grab hold of their hands together, and I want you to come forward, and we want to pray. We want to pray. I'm not saying force somebody to come up. Well, yeah, maybe I am. Go ahead. Force somebody to come up. But this is the habitation of His glory, where hearts are coming together. That's what He's looking for. Hearts coming together. So I'm just going to ask you to come. And we got plenty of ministers here, and they can pray. And we're just going to believe God for the filling of the sanctuary, the filling of the temple. It's not temples. Remember, this is all one temple. This is all one temple. So, Lord, thank you. Thank you that you desired us. You created us to be a habitation for your glory, that we are your dwelling place. Together, as we unite together, we pray, Lord Jesus, that you would unite our hearts in faith and trust, unite our hearts in pursuit of your heart, unite us as one to trust and believe in you, O God, to fill us to overflowing with all that you have, all that you are, all that you desire. Lord God, we thank you in this place that you didn't leave us powerless. You didn't leave us without your presence. We thank you for your presence in this place, and we magnify you, O God. We say, let God be lifted up in this place. Let God be lifted up in our hearts, O Lord. We just say, have your way in this place, Lord Jesus. Have your play in our lives, O God. Lord, let the connections that are fitted rightly together, Lord, let them grow up into fullness of Jesus Christ, into the full stature and measure of Jesus today. Lord God, we thank you that you fill this place with your glory. You fill this temple that has come together, brick by brick, stone by stone, that you're filling the breaches, you're filling the places, you're filling every part of the body of Christ, that we might have the strength and the glory that you've always longed for, that you desire for your kingdom, O God. We thank you, O Lord. We welcome you in this place. We say, be lifted up, O God. Lord, we are so thankful for the pouring forth of your presence, of your goodness, your loving kindness. They are new every day. Your mercies are new every day. Your fullness is new for this day. We thank you. We receive fullness. We receive filling for this day, right now in Jesus' name. Filling for this house. I receive from every vessel the filling of this house. That this house is filled to overflowing because the vessels are filled to overflowing. That this temple of God is filled with your glory. We thank you that this is the kingdom of your habitation, a kingdom of holy habitation, oh God. We receive that calling on this house today. We walk in that place, Lord Jesus, and we thank you that you meet us here. You meet us. You fill us with yourself, oh God, and we go in strength and power and glory. We go in this our strength. Just even as Moses came down from the mountain and his face shining with the glory of God, I declare the shining of the glory of God of all the vessels of the temple of God that is going forth today from this place. We thank you, Jesus, for every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. We receive every good and perfect gift in this house for the building up of the body of Christ. Lord, we are not missing any good thing. No good thing do you withhold from them that walk uprightly. We thank you, Jesus, this kingdom, that you are continuing to bring your vessels. We are gathering the vessels, Lord, that you might fill this place with your glory. Thank you, Jesus, all that you are doing, all that you continue to do. May grace, peace, and mercy be with you both now and forevermore and until Jesus comes. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. If you just want to keep worshiping, just please do it. If you need to be dismissed, please go in the grace and favor and blessing of God. Amen. Amen. God, you are so good.